Hi, I'm Amelia, a social psychologist working at Universitas Erlangga in Indonesia. Today, I'm going to talk about the danger of sensationalist scientific claims and how openness impedes its destructive impact. So, first of all, I could not overstate the importance of science during this very difficult time, but we collectively may have been making an impressive progress with the help of science. Vaccines are now available and ready to roll out. Diagnostic tests are slightly easier to access compared to the beginning of the outbreak. And across the globe, the trust in science and scientists is much stronger, despite many people would value practical experience over expertise, according to a US-based Pew Research Center study. However, today I'm going to tell you a very different story. And I believe it happens everywhere, not just in Indonesia, but the consequences of these dismal scientific claims are unimaginable. So, in June last year, Universitas Erlangga announced that they found several drugs combinations very effective to combat the virus. The idea was nothing new, but the claims were extraordinary. The findings were the first in the world and highly powerful in curing the disease. The research was unfortunately very premature, and none of the public records was found related to the invention, making it very difficult to assess the claims. The study was conducted in collaboration with the State Intelligence Agency and the Indonesian Army. There was unfortunately a public attack on prominent critic of this study, Pandu Riono of Universitas Indonesia, an epidemiologist who criticized the study from the very beginning, was attacked on Twitter. His Twitter account was hijacked, and the hijacker posted a number of pictures aimed to damage Pandu's reputation. However, at last, in August, the Indonesian Drug and Food Supervisory Agency rejected the request of granting the drug authorization of emergency use. The next one, a team of researchers from Universitas Gadjah Mada claimed to invent a groundbreaking diagnostic tool to screen COVID-infected people, which takes a form of a breath analyzer. The tool was claimed to be cheaper, faster, and in close accuracy to the PCR tests. The tool detects volatile organic compounds uniquely found in COVID patients. The Ministry of Health eventually grants distribution permits, and the tool is now widely used to screen passengers in airports, in train stations, and soon to be used in hospitals, schools, and also offices. The government even plans to widely use the tool in tourist attractions for the sake of restoring the economy back to normal. Worth to note that the public information about the study is minimal, and the researchers were particularly hostile to anyone criticizing their findings on social media. At last, a former controversial Indonesian Health Minister, Terawan Agus Putranto, announced that his team is developing a dendritic cell-based vaccine, and he called it Vaksin Nusantara. Despite the unconventional approach of developing a vaccine, the team claims that it would produce stronger cellular antibodies that could last a lifetime. Such extraordinary claims were frowned upon as being impossible and unsuitable for emergency rollout. Terawan was infamously known for playing down the scale of pandemic when holding the ministerial position, and was rumored to abuse his power as a minister to push his own vaccine research. The similarity of those controversial studies is the vagueness of the details. The public is not allowed to access the comprehensive report of the study despite the use of public funding. It is then very difficult to evaluate the integrity of the claims, but on the other hand, these findings could have a real impact to the people's lives. Public outcry often collides with ethno-nationalist sentiments where the research teams and government bodies involved invalidates critics by saying that those critics are unappreciative to the fellow Indonesians' creations, sometimes followed by a conspiracist ideation that the critics were allegedly pro-foreign interests and not being proud of their nation. The dangerous part of these big claims is the bigger the claim, the faster it ceases. It is an unfortunate waste of public money and risking public trust in science. It's impossible to expect lay people would trust and listen to scientists, while scientists themselves refuse to hold themselves accountable for their own claims. According to a study that I read just recently, that the public would put their trust in scientists based on their effort to get the research right, not for being right, which is quite interesting. Owning limitation and acknowledging critics is rarely valued, unfortunately. When scientists are rushed, their findings to achieve their egoistic goals. This is a downside when science is seen as a rat race, not a careful, meticulous effort to pursue the truth. A lesson learned from those cases is that Indonesian government is certainly not anti-science. They're not anti-science. But they certainly use science and sciences as a token to please the public and a mere tool to exercise their own political agenda. This is a typical characteristic of populism and anti-intellectualism. But these dark sides could perhaps be prevented should scientists adopt open scientific practices. Since openness allows the scientific community to check the integrity and potentially advance the findings more, openness means placing the public interest at the top of priority. However, openness requires intellectual humility, and it is virtually impossible to grow such virtue in a highly competitive environment. Open science would definitely be helpful in this case. Practicing open scientific practices could be a signal that the research teams have a strong commitment to pursue the highest quality research. By allowing others' feedback, unfounded claims could be easily debunked and would advance only potential research. By performing robustness checks, the scientific community could protect the public's interest and avoid damaging effects. Practicing open science could also improve public trust in scientific research. Owning limitation, taking uncertainty into account, making clear boundaries between the known and the unknown could help educate the public on how science actually works. Big claims indeed make headlines, bring fame to the scientists, but being intellectually humble would make them a better scientist. Thank you for watching, and I'm very looking forward to hearing your feedback.